Good morning, and welcome to our celebration of the 27th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Our tabernacle flowers are donated by the Griner family in memory of Simon Griner. This Mass is being offered for Linda Baustert. Our opening song is The Church's One Foundation. Please stand.
Good morning.
Good morning,
Father. God always invites us to be with Him. Today, in the readings, in a very special way, through the first reading and the gospel reading, God is inviting us to work in His vineyard, to be fruitful, to be happy. And today, as we have gathered here to receive the Eucharist, let's ask Jesus that we might be fruitful in our life. And today we are also celebrating the feast of fancies of Assisi, who was fruitful, who was happy, who spread the good news to others. Let's ask him to intercede for us in this Eucharistic celebration. And now we shall begin our Mass. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
Amen.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Let's ask God to forgive our sins and make us worthy to celebrate this Eucharist.
Lord Jesus, you have shown us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you have given us the consolation of the truth. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd, leading us into everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who in the abundance of your kindness surpass the merits and desires of those who entreat you, pour out your mercy upon us to pardon what conscience dreads and to give what prayer does not dare to ask. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let me now sing of my friend's song concerning his vineyard. My friend had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He spaded it, cleared it of stones, and planted the choicest vines. Within it, he built a watchtower, and he hewed out a wine press. Then he looked for the crop of grapes, but what it yielded was wild grapes. Now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I had not done? Why then I looked for the crop of grapes. Did it bring forth wild grapes? Now I will let you know what I mean to do with my vineyard. Take away its hedge, give it to grazing. Break through its wall, let it be trampled. Yes, I will make it a ruin. It shall not be pruned or hoed, but overgrown with thorns and briars. I will command the clouds not to send rain upon it. The vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his cherished plant. He looked for judgment, but see bloodshed. For justice, but hark the outcry. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, have no anxiety at all, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. Then the peace of God, that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. Then the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
According to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "Hear another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. Then he leased it to tenants and went on a journey. When vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to obtain his produce. But the tenants seized the servants, and one they beat, another they killed, and a third they stoned. Again, he sent other servants, more numerous than the first ones, but they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, thinking, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to one another, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and acquire his inheritance.' They seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. What will the owner of the vineyard do to those tenants when he comes?" They answered him, "He will put those wretched men to a wretched death and lease his vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the proper times." Jesus said to them, "Did you never read in the scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done, and it is wonderful in our eyes. Therefore I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that will produce its fruit." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Jesus Christ.
When I first came to Oklahoma City, I was in a parish, Epiphany Parish, maybe some of you know that. In one of my Sunday homily, I was talking to them about farming and harvesting. And I told that we have 2 acres of rice field and how we used to go and work. After the mass, one of the parishioners came and said, "Father, do you want to see my farm, rice farm?" I said, "Yes, I love it." He took me somewhere close to Tulsa. He was driving. Both the side, there was rice. He was driving for 10 minutes, 15 minutes. He was just kept driving. And in one place, he stopped. And we got down. He said, "This is my land. This is my rice field." As far as I could see, it was only rice field, maybe a couple of miles, even more. And I asked him, "How much land you own here?" He said, 500 acres of land. "Only that much?" He said, "No, a few more people have this." And then he started me to drive the other side, and I asked him, "When do you cultivate all these things, such a huge land?" He said, "I don't do it, Father. I have a business in Oklahoma City. I leased it." And he took me to the other side. There was combines harvesting the rice. Huge machines. I was so surprised to see. And I asked him, "How often you come to this place?" He said, "Usually once a year during the harvest season. Sometimes in between, maybe twice a year." "Do you trust this person?" He said, "Yes. He's very sincere, hardworking, gives me the profit on time, never delays. I trust him. I give my 500 acres of land to him." Dear brothers and sisters, leasing things, leasing land is not something new even in this 21st century. We rent our car or vehicles. We rent or lease our houses if we have 2 or 3 houses, and we lease our land. Imagine 2,000 years ago, the same situation in Jerusalem and places around. The land owners, the landlords, they have hundreds of acres of land. They don't work there. They do all the things necessary and lease it to people and come back once a year. Sometimes they don't even come once a year. They come once in 5, 10 years. But they send people to collect the profit. We heard 3 words in the readings today, first reading and the gospel reading. Landlords. The one who owns the land, the one who spends on the vineyard, he plants the vineyard, he fences around it, he even builds a tower to watch if there are any wild animals coming. Wine press, everything was provided, then given to people to work, to be responsible, and to produce. Were the tenants today in the gospel reading responsible? Were they responsible? No. When the servants came, they stoned one, they killed the other, and humiliated the other person. And the tenants were not responsible, not fruitful. And Jesus looks at them and asks, "What do the landlord do when he comes?" Very important question. And why is Jesus saying this parable to priests and the elders? Because that's what God has done to the people of Israel. God called Abraham. God called his son Isaac, Jacob. God called Moses, the people of Israel, when they were working as slaves in Egypt. He brought them miraculously for 40 years in the desert. He gave them the land. He made them owners of the land. Are they grateful? Are they fruitful? No. When God sent prophets, they ill-treated them, they humiliated them, persecuted them, and killed them. So when Jesus spoke this parable, the Pharisees, the teachers, the elders understood Jesus is talking about them. God has given everything that you needed, and it was given to you in your hands. You are not responsible. You are not fruitful. What will the landowner do? When he comes, he takes away the land from you, and you will be put to death. The wretched people will be put to death, and the land would be taken away from them. So when Jesus spoke this parable, the people hearing that understood he is talking about them. And today, we are hearing the same parable. The parable is talking to us. Are we responsible? Are we fruitful? Oftentimes we hear say, this is my land. So Anthony Di Melo, in one of his books, he says, God smiles every time people fight over the land, saying, this is mine. We come and we go. Land is here. Land and the things that we have doesn't belong to anyone else, but God's. God gave it to us. We are tenants. We are servants. We are stewards. Few weeks back in the book of Job, in daily mass readings, we heard Job telling, naked I came from my mother's womb, naked I shall return. I did not bring anything. I will not take anything. Whatever we have is God's. The land belongs to landowner who is God himself. Whatever we have, our land. If you are born in this country, did we choose to be born? Any one of you here? Chose to be born in America? We are born here. God has given us this land. Are we responsible? Are we fruitful? God has given this church, one holy Catholic church. How blessed, how wonderful it is to be part of this church instituted by Jesus. He called us to this vineyard. Are we responsible? Are we fruitful? God has given us life 40 years, 50 years, 80, 90 years for some of you. The landowner will come back one day. What have you done with 80 years of your life that I gave you? What have you done with all the blessings that I have given you in your life? As Christians and Catholics, we are baptized here. Just as the vineyard was fenced around, dug the ground, planted, there's watchtower, everything was provided. We are provided with so many things in life, both physically, materially, even physically. Every Sunday, Jesus is feeding us with his own body and blood. He is feeding us with the sacrament of reconciliation, sacrament of ordination, and sacrament of matrimony. God has done everything for us in this vineyard. When the landlord comes, he would ask, are you fruitful? Are you responsible? And if you're not fruitful, if you're not responsible, we know what will happen. Let's ask Jesus to help us that we might be fruitful and responsible for all the things that we have for our own life. We need to be responsible and fruitful. And today, we also remember Peru Mission Weekend. And Father Joe could not come because of this COVID-19 issue. But now I invite Cheryl Pierce to come and talk to us about Peru Mission.
Thank you, Father Anthony. Good afternoon. My name is Cheryl Pierce. I'm a member of St. John's Peru Mission Board. Did you know that this is Peru Mission Weekend? Under normal circumstances, you'd be hearing from Father Joe and one or two of his staff members about what's happening in our sister parish, Santissimo Sacramento, in Piura, Peru. But then, these are not normal times. So today I'd like to take an opportunity to let you know that despite the pandemic, the people of Piura are filled with hope and overjoyed with love and support that they are receiving from all of you. Around the second week of March, all of Peru shut down. The borders were closed, and they're still closed. Everyone was told to stay home. Curfews were set, masks were required, and fines were issued for non-compliance. The country did all the right things. However, with crowded and poor living conditions, inadequate health care, lack of savings, people still had to be out looking for work and food, and the virus spread. Today, Peru ranks right up there with Brazil as one of the highest incidences of mortality for COVID-19. Father Joe and his staff recognized immediately that the poor people of his parish would need extra support. The family-to-family food packages could not be delivered due to the travel restrictions and curfews, so they decided to temporarily provide monthly money packages instead. The daily breakfast kitchens that St. John has supported for so many years continue to feed over 800 children in the villages, and many families that are not even part of the family-to-family program are being provided for as well. Venezuelan refugees are making the long trip back home since there's no work for them and no place to stay. They pass by the church on their way north to Ecuador. Father Joe and the staff are providing them with a small amount of money, a bag of food and water for their long 28 journey home, 28 days of walking. We loaded a 40-foot container in March that was filled with your family-to-family boxes, clothes, household items, and mission team supplies. Little did we know it would take 4 months to get there. Immediately, I heard from Veronica, the parish nurse, asking if they could use our medical mission supplies and did we send any antibiotics. Up until July, the clinic was not allowed to see patients. So once they had received our boxes of medicine, the three staff nurses began filling prescriptions and hand delivering them to the families in the villages. As they were out, they also recognized the need for oxygen. Families were struggling. It cost $300 to rent a large tank of oxygen and $60 to refill it. A new mission was started, the oxygen mission, as Father Joe calls it. Through donations, the parish is able to rent the tanks and help pay for refills. When the government closed the churches, Father Joe began streaming daily mass and daily rosary on Facebook. Prayer requests fill the comment sections every day. He continues to visit the sick in the hospitals, in their homes. He's visited the men in the local prison and provided them with toiletry packages and face masks, and continues to reach out to the isolated villagers and farmers as well. Well, how is all this possible? It's through people like you. Whether you are new to the ministry or have supported the mission over the last 22 years, your participation has given life and hope to the people of Piura. I have seen how your monthly food packages have improved the overall health of families and continue to help break that cycle of poverty as families graduate from the program and are capable of supporting themselves. I have seen how proud the children are to be able to attend public schools because someone from St. John provided the entrance fees and how they treasure those books and school supplies that we send on the container. I've seen the smiling faces of mothers who take their disabled children for free therapy services at the physical rehabilitation center that St. John helped build. And I know how much your families mean to you, and I know how much they mean to them, how much you mean to them. Every time I walk into one of their homes, I see your pictures on the wall right under their prayer table, and they pray for you every day. That's why I'm here today, to ask you for your generous support for Father Joe and his staff at Santissimo Sacramento so they can continue to provide for the least of our brothers and sisters in Piura, Peru. We've placed envelopes at the hospitality desk and the entrances to the sanctuary for your donations. You can also mail your checks to St. John directly or make credit card donations through the St. Joseph Peruvian Mission Fund at www.peruvianmissionfund.org. It's on the envelope. We have board members in the gathering space to answer any questions. One last thing. Father Joe sent a beautiful YouTube video that we've added to the St. John's webpage. Be sure to check it out. Thank you so much, and Dios te bendiga. God bless you.
We shall all stand and profess our faith. I believe in one God.
I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Trusting in God, our Father, we shall pray for our needs.
The congregational response is, Lord, hear us. May our Holy Father Francis, Archbishop Paul, and all the clergy receive your inspiration, Lord, in guiding the Catholic Church during these difficult times, we pray.
Lord, hear us.
That in our own lives we may bear the fruit of love, forgiveness, justice, and peace, we pray.
Lord, hear us.
May all people, from military personnel, our president and the first lady, to our families, may they seek strength and peace under the protective mantle of your loving Son, we pray.
Lord, hear us.
That we may respond generously in giving to the many good works of Catholic Charities and our Peru mission, we pray.
Lord, hear us.
As modern-day tenants of the vineyard, may we bear good fruit in every aspect of our lives, we pray.
Lord, hear us.
May the sick and suffering of our parish never lose heart in the midst of their trials, but be strengthened by the word of God and the kindness of others, we pray.
Lord,
for those who have gone before us marked with the sign of faith, that they may know eternal happiness in heaven, we pray.
Lord, hear us.
For the prayers we've offered before the Blessed Sacrament and all of the unspoken prayers that we hold within us, we pray.
Let us pray. God, our Father, accept all the prayers that we have offered to you and continue to bless us and help us to be responsible and fruitful in our life. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
pray, brothers and sisters, that this my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the sacrifices instituted by your commands and through the sacred mysteries, which we celebrate with dutiful service, graciously complete the sanctifying work by which you are pleased to redeem us, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for we know it belongs to your boundless glory that you came to the aid of mortal beings with your divinity and even fashioned for us remedy out of mortality itself, that the cause of our downfall might become the means of our salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him the host of angels adore your majesty and rejoices in your presence forever. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in one chorus of exultant praise as we acclaim. Fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Paul, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also, brothers and sisters, who have fallen asleep in the hope of resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with the Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the Blessed Apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Pray for the coming of God's kingdom as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Jesus Christ be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word.
With me, footprints in the sand, and help me understand where I'm going. You walked with me when I was all alone, with so much unknown along the way. heard you say, I promise you, I'm always there. When your heart is filled with sorrow and despair, I'll carry you when you need a friend. You'll find my footprints in the sand. I see my life flash across the sky. So many times have I been so afraid. Just when I thought I lost my way, you gave me strength to carry on. It's when I heard you say, I promise to you, I'm always there. When your heart is filled with sorrow and despair, and I'll carry you when you need a friend. You'll find my footprints in the sand. You'll find my footprints in the sand.
Thank you.
pray to St. Michael the Archangel. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us. Be our defense against the wickedness and snares of. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of Heavenly Host, may the power of God thrust into hell Satan, all the evil spirits. We have few announcements. Today is the feast of St. Francis of Assisi. So we invite you to bring your pet for a special blessing. Today at 2 p.m. on the playground, south side of the school. Fatima Rosary, next Sunday, that's October 10th, at noon on the east parking lot. For more details, kindly refer to the bulletin. Flu shots next Sunday morning, October 11th, and again on Tuesday, October 13th, in the Parish Center. For more details, refer the bulletin. Now we shall all stand for the final blessing. Let us pray. Grant us, Almighty God, that we may be refreshed and nourished by the sacrament which we have received, so as to be transformed into what we consume, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.